myself, Dr. Ranum Dabas. I am basically a veterinary doctor, having a total experience of around 8 years. And for last 4 years, I'm working as a scientist in Food Safety and Standards Authority of India. And today, here we are going to discuss about the antibiotics and its regulatory perspectives. But before going with the regulatory perspectives, we have to know that what are exactly antibiotics, what are its uses, and why exactly we need a regulation, a strict regulation for antibiotics in the country. Antibiotics are basically compounds. They may be of natural origin, or they may be semi-synthetic, or they may be of synthetic origin, which are used for inhibition of the growth of microorganisms, but without causing any significant toxicity to their animal or human hosts. They are used for therapeutic purposes when a certain animal is diagnosed with some kind of disease. So with the medical practitioner, a veterinary practitioner prescribes a particular antimicrobial for that particular disease. They are also used for prophylactic purposes when animals are basically healthy, but they are posed to some kind of risk of diseases. So in that case, for prophylactic purposes, we use antibiotics. And nowadays, we are also using antibiotics for non-therapeutic purposes in the absence of any disease or any documented exposure to any microbial disease. So in non-therapeutic use of antibiotics, antibiotics are used in very nominal amount, and they are basically used for growth promotion, for weight gain purposes, for feed utilization, and for preventing the diseases which are caused by bad sanitation, which usually happens in cases of intensive farming of animals, where there is a high density of animals and poor biosecurity, and there are chances of spread of disease. So in that case also, non-therapeutic use of antibiotics is. Antimicrobials are being used by industry as a growth promoter, and these are used for very low sub-therapeutic doses in feed and water. These are mainly used for reducing the subclinical population of pathogenic microorganisms in the gut mass of animals, which ultimately leads to lessening the metabolic drain. This also helps in preventing the irritation to the intestinal lining of animals, and it increases the passage of food through the gut, which allows the increased daily gain and the utilization of feed in animals. Antimicrobials are also being used in livestock feeds, and they are sprayed on plants and the livestock feed or poultry feed or fish feed, and the studies have shown that almost 75% of these antibiotics passed as such without any alteration in the feces, and this antibiotics causes resistant pathogens which are being excreted by livestock, and they are being available in the environment to wildlife and the grazing livestock. This can cause contamination of crops, and this ultimately leads to the transfer of bacteria from animals to humans. Due to rampant use of these antibiotics as growth promoters and in feed, a lot of antimicrobial resistance is being witnessed in these days. And this happens because many drugs are in the same class as human drugs. And the prolonged bacterial exposure to these long-term and low doses of antibiotics increases the resistance to that particular drug. And when animals are administered an antibiotic which is closely related to that antibiotic class in human, cross-resistance occurs. Due to this resistance, this leads to foodborne infections in human also, which would have been otherwise more severe, they last longer, and they're more likely to lead to infections that may cause death also. Because of this, there is an ultimate need for strict regulation of these antimicrobial drugs, these antibiotics, as well as other veterinary drugs. And a lot of initiatives have been taken in international as well as national scenario. First, we have a look on the international scenario. The responsibility for providing advice or for the risk management, this Codex Alimentarius Commission and its subsidiary body, that is Codex Committee on Residues of Veterinary Drugs in Food, CCRVDF, is responsible. And for scientific advice, for the risk assessment, for Codex work, there is a particular committee, that is the Joint FAO-WHO Expert Committee on Food Additives, that is JECFA, which is an independent scientific expert body convened by the FAO and WHO. Few steps are taken for this particular purpose for the regulation of drugs, in which the first step is establishment of a priority list. The Codex Committee of Residues of Veterinary Drugs and Foods, CCRVDF, it identifies with the assistance of members of the committee the veterinary drugs that may pose a consumer safety problem or may have a potential adverse impact on the international trade. Once this list is prepared by the CCRVDF, a preliminary risk profile is prepared by the members of the committee or by the sponsors. And this information is compiled on a particular template which is already prepared by CCRVDF. In the third step, there is ranking of the hazard for the risk assessment and risk management priority, which is done by the CAC. After the approval by the CAC of the priority list of veterinary drugs, finally the CCRVDF forwards this information to JECFA for the qualitative preliminary risk profile as well as the specific guidance on the CCRVDF risk assessment request. JECFA, WHO and FAO experts then proceed with the assessment of risk which are related to these veterinary drugs based on the dossier which has been provided to them and also the other scientific information available with them. Now in the fifth step, there is consideration of the result of the risk assessment, and when the JECFA has completed its risk assessment part, the report is sent to the CCRVDF in the subsequent session for their consideration. JECFA only establishes the acceptable daily intake for MANs, that is ADIs, for the veterinary drugs, and they also recommends the maximum residue limits, that are MRLs, for the residues of veterinary drugs in food of animal origin. And while deriving the MRLs from the ADIs of a veterinary drug, JECFA takes into account the total amount of potentially active residues and a conservative theoretical food basket that consists of muscle, liver, kidney, fat, milk, for eggs and for honey. In this scenario, JECFA may recommend an MRL or a temporary MRL. They may recommend an MRL which is unnecessary or unspecified. This happens in situations when there is a wide range of safety. Or there may be no MRL recommended by JECFA, as JECFA may not support the use of that particular drug for food producing animals, or there may not be any significant residues or methodology data. Now we come to the Indian scenario, how regulation is maintained in the country. In India, Central Drug Standard Control Organization, CDSCO, which is under Directorate General of Health Services, DGHS, under Ministry of Health and Family Welfare, is the main regulatory body which is associated for the regulation of veterinary and pharmaceutical drugs, medical devices and clinical trials. Matters pertaining to this drug approval and standard, clinical trials, introduction of new drugs, import licenses of new drugs, all these issues are handled by the Drug Controller General of India, that is DCGI, which is the head of CDSCO. This work is done by DCGI with the help of their two committees, Drug Technical Advice Board, DTAB, and Drug Consultative Committee, DCC. There is a well-established and standardized procedure for regulatory process in India. And for any new drug, applicant has to apply in Investigational New Drug Department. And this happens in the CDSCO headquarter. This new application is examined by the New Drug Division, which the detailed review is done by the committee and the recommendations are sent to DCGI for their consideration. If the application is approved, the relevant information is sent for the clinical trial. Along with this, the application is simultaneously sent to the ethical committee also. And if the report of the ethical committee is positive, within a time period of 12 weeks, both these reports are sent to the clinical trial. Then the report of ethical committee and the clinical trial, both are sent to the CDSCO for the registration of the new drug. And if it is approved by DCGI, the license is granted in case when drugs are being approved. And they are refused if they are not, the clinical trials and ethical committee reports are not appropriate. So this was the flow of regulation of a new drug in our country. Now, several regulatory initiatives has also been taken by our country, like Bureau of Indian Standards have specified poultry feed specifications, they have specified livestock feed specifications as well as fish feed specifications, and they have recommended not using these antibiotics with systemic actions as growth promoters in feed. They have also mentioned the phasing out of gut acting antibiotics within the 5 years of time period. The Drugs and Cosmetic Rules 2013, which is the fourth amendment of Drugs and Cosmetic Act 1945, they have introduced a new H1 schedule for antibiotics, which says that certain drugs have to be monitored and regulated for the use of human, and it is not to be sold without the prescription of a registered medical practitioner. A national policy on containment of antimicrobial resistance has also been finalized in 2011, which mentions about the need for developing regulations on usage of antimicrobials as well as the requisite labeling requirements in food. It talks about the surveillance of resistance, promoting rational antibiotic use through education, monitoring and supervision, and researching new drugs. On the basis of this national policy, a national program on containment of antimicrobial resistance was initiated in 2012 for 5 years, aimed to establish a laboratory-based surveillance system in the country and generate awareness on the rational use of antibiotics and strengthening the hospital infection control guidelines. There have been some circulars also issued by our ministries, like a circular was issued by Drugs and Cosmetics Act. The container of the medicine for treatment of food producing animals shall be labeled with their withdrawal period of the drug for the species on which it is intended to be used. If the specific withdrawal period is not mentioned, it should not be used less than 28 days for meat and poultry. Animal husbandry commissioners were issued with a circular by Department of Animal Husbandry and Dairy in 2014. And Ministry of Agriculture issued this circular requesting all the states to advise their veterinarians to use these antibiotics judiciously, and it was mentioned that the use of antibiotics in feed has to be stopped. And last but not the least, Food Safety and Standards Authority of India has taken several initiatives like Food Safety and Standards Contaminants, Toxins and Residues Regulation 2011 was notified, which establishes the MRS for antibiotics in seafoods including shrimps, prawns, etc. And also the use of certain antibiotics in seafood processing units was prohibited. Food Safety and Standards Authority of India has also established certain subject-specific scientific panels which recommends maximum residue limits for veterinary drugs in animals food origin from time to time. So this is how veterinary drug residues are being regulated in our country. Thank you.